I'm going to take just a few minutes here first to summarize some of the points we've been hearing and make some points about what the things that may link them together may be as the setup goes on, to then have our speakers come up. And I have a stack of questions that have been sent to them, but then also we'll open it up for questions from the floor. I think it's very interesting that one of the themes that ties together, particularly our first two talks, is the theme of making. And also the theme in those talks, I thought, came through quite clearly of social participation over consumerism. And then we heard a very interesting discussion about how so consumerism can, in fact, support social participation rather than the conversation that went on for so long about the ways in which the museum was becoming a commercialized space. At the IFI, you certainly still know whether you're in the cafe, whether you're in the shop, or whether you're watching a film. And in some of these museums, the boundaries between, I was once in the National Gallery of Washington where I was actually looking at a painting this way and down the other way looking at a reproduction of it hanging in the shop. You could see the both at the same time, which I have to say was distracting. And but I find it very refreshing that we're able to talk about social participation in the way that we have been doing here. David called for museums to be people-oriented rather than object-oriented, and also talked about, raised the issue of how museums can promote morality. Peggy highlighted works by artists as well as the way that museum staff are trying to make the museum more inclusive while very much working with and around the objects. And Sarah described in some detail, and I think very openly and honestly, the challenges of functioning not just in the Irish context today, but in the global context today, where most institutions have much less money, and how you use commercialization to support your program and sustain your program rather than simply changing the program to respond to commercial demands. So I'd like to, and all of our speakers, I'd like to thank them also for keeping them on track very much to time so that I wasn't the bad guy having to come up and try to stop somebody. I'd like to invite the three of them, please, to come sit here. I have three questions I'd like to ask that I have gotten on cards, I assume, from the people who are watching remotely, and then I'm going to open it up to the audience, and we have quite a bit of time still because they were all so prompt. So please just your patience while they come up and take the seats. And Mary and Margherita, would you like to come up as well, because there may well be questions for you also. I'm going to stay here. Please, come on up. That's I'm sorry, I didn't mean to be in the way.
Should we?
Yes, just walk around. Yes. You give me a sort of a look that you're in. No, I'm staying here. So. My first question from the internet, I presume, is for David.
Sorry, we're playing musical chairs.
Right. My first question is for David. Does Wales have a national art gallery? And if so, does it have a role in defining national identity? This comes from Anne Stewart.
We have a national museum of art as of July last year. When we reopened the top floor of the museum at Cates Park in Cardiff. And it most certainly has a role in debating the issues of the relationship between art in Wales and international art. And this has always been, a point of tension, really, I think, in discussion of the role of the museum. And one that has produced different resolutions at different points in the past. I would like to think, and I believe a lot of people who've seen the newly reopened museum would say as well, that for now, anyway, we've reached a position which most of our visitors and most commentators seem to be seem to think is an effective one. We have placed contemporary Welsh art and historical Welsh art in the context of international art, and at the same time have done so, I think, with an interpretive approach that has got a Welsh voice to it too. We could talk in more detail about that, but yes, it's something we've addressed.
A question now for Peggy from Tim McGrain. The Met Museum deals with an historic collection, much like the National Gallery here, but it has recently begun collecting contemporary artwork. It's actually been collecting it for a while, but much more aggressively now. Does this present a challenge for the museum and for the education department, and how have both adjusted to this?
I know I have to speak into this.
Yes, not to me. You're speaking out to the...
I would say that it doesn't pose a challenge. In fact, it's a tremendous advantage, I think, to collect contemporary art within the context of a historic encyclopedic collection. And one of the things that, you know, we like to say at the Met is our collections are so expansive and cover basically every region of the world throughout history that everyone can find a story relevant to them. Everyone can find their own story within the collections of the Met. And of course, one of the things we want to ensure is that we stay relevant, and that in finding your own story, you can make the connection to life today, and the contemporary art collection only serves to help us to do that and to connect past and present and understand both continuities and ruptures within human creation over the course of time. So I actually would not consider it a challenge, I would consider it a substantial advantage to us.
Thank you. Sarah, do museums have anything to gain from edutainment / creative industries, this sector, vis-a-vis their approach to business promotion and audience development from Laura Mulvaney?
I think there are things that can be learned. As a, you know, I was sort of trying to perhaps highlight in my talk, there's, from my own experience of working in a museum and gallery context to working in a context that very much is about cultural enterprise, about a very real and very tangible connection with audience and a very tangible awareness of audience at all time. I think there are things that perhaps sometimes a financial imperative that we sort of find in organizations like the IFI and other performing venues would be operating in the same kind of environment. I think they do make you think creatively, they make you think imaginatively and quite flexibly, you know, in terms of different ways of approaching things. And I think there's something there that museums could learn from and look to.
Questions from the floor. I have more questions here too, and I have some of my own, but I'd like to open it up to people from the floor. Yes, all the way in the back there. There's a roving mic, which I'd ask you to use so that people who are watching this remotely can hear you. Yes.
I think it was David Williams raised the issue of epistemic injustice, and I think it leads to not an injustice to the knower, but also to those that don't know. And as a consequence, there's confusion over direction of where to go with museums, and that stems from the economic chaos. And essentially, museums do not present the truths of the dishonesties within the subjects of the displayed objects of their own times or of past times or of objects they purposely choose to omit, and hence the public do not trust museums.
David?
I suppose I would question how much the public doesn't trust museums. I think quite a lot of surveys have suggested that compared with very, very many other sources of information / interpretation, museums and galleries are still relatively trusted. I wouldn't question that there are also many people who do challenge them as well.
Just to interrupt, I use the word trust in the same sense that we now do not trust the economic solutions that are being put forward, because the past we felt that we had trust that past has now been realized as a false trust. And in the same way, the museums, the trust, will turn out to be a false trust. We don't yet realize it.
I see. So it's a predictive statement, if you like, to a degree.
Exactly.
Yes. And I mean, I was going to go on to say that I think also that trust is very conditional, and in a sense localized as well too. And what can be trusted in one context may not be trusted in another. And as a case in point, we have an exhibition on in the National Museum of Wales, in the National Museum of Art, in fact, there, on the Queen. It's curated by the National Portrait Gallery, has toured to Edinburgh, Belfast, and Cardiff before going back to London. And in Cardiff, the social history curators have added a dimension to the exhibition, which is about, drawn from our collections, about representations of the Queen in Wales. And that's been a very provocative intervention in many ways. And most of the coverage, in fact, in the media of that exhibition has been about the Welsh intervention into that exhibition, more than the core, a much bigger section, which is the National Portrait Gallery's originating exhibition. And I think I think there would have been a question of trust for our organization if we have not had that Welsh element to the exhibition. And the content of it is very challenging as well. I think I agree with the premise, I think, that you're proposing, which is trust has to be earned, and that it's based on performance, and it will be judged later.
I think if you put it back to your other comment about the Welsh family that felt disowned within their own town because it had become Englishified, I think that's an example of the consequences of a breakdown in trust. They don't understand why they have lost their ownership rights to their own town, why it's been taken over by other groups. It's because museums are not presenting the truths about the dishonesties which caused the loss of their heritage.
Yes, here further forward from the, if you got, just waiting for the mic there for you.
I'm just curious about, for Sarah, the IFI's member program has always been, you know, it's looked very successful to me. I'm a member and, you know, I like the rewards and benefits. So I was curious, how will you use that, you know, the challenges and successes that the IFI's had with that, how will you use that in a very different scenario, you know, at the IMA? Or if you don't want to say that, how do you think institutions that aren't quite like the IFI with the burgers and the euro off the ticket cost, how can we learn from that kind of engagement with that core 9,000 membership that the IFI has?
Well, I mean, I don't have the answers of how that's directly transferable, and I'm very aware, as I say, that the film context is a very particular one, but I think perhaps there's kind of attitudes in the way that we've approached it that are worth taking and remembering and kind of bringing forward. I think that point about the membership being a point of inclusivity and a reward to the audience rather than a kind of one-way support to the institution, I think is very important. I think price point, it's sort of a bone of contention I have a lot around, but it should be something that is accessible. There's an awful lot of people who use the institutions very regularly and want to feel connected with that, but in order to become a member, need to be paying, say, 50, 100 euro, and that isn't always accessible for everyone. So I think it's about seeing the membership as more than just an income generator and a part of a fundraising strategy. And it's about, now for us, it's a dual-edged thing. It is very much about income, and it is a very important income stream for us. But we realize more and more that it's actually much more than that. It's about a group of people who remain with us, remain loyal to us, remain connected to us. And that's what we try and respect and remember at all times. So I think they're things that are very particular to the IFI. And again, thinking about it being an organization with a sort of very big cafe and that being a very big part of it, it's still, one of the things I really found when I went into it was a really, and this has been brutally honest, but a kind of a deep disrespect of audience in many ways. You know, the cinemas could be too hot. It's something we still suffer from. We have a dreadful air conditioning system. But, you know, that wasn't seen as an issue. There was a kind of sense of come to us, see our films, make of it what you will. And if the cafe isn't great, that's okay. Or if the staff were a bit rude, that's okay. And that was something I felt very strongly about and do still feel very strongly about, that people invest their time in us, they invest their time to come to us, and that we need to respect that. And that needs to sort of underline all aspects of what we do. So I suppose what I was trying to sort of indicate a bit in my presentation was that while they're very particular things that, as they are, can be very much about income and or very much about the particular context of the IFI, it's an attitude towards audience that I think is very important and really fundamental to the kind of vitality and success of an organization. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yes, there on the aisle. The mic's coming.
As we're talking about the future of museums here, I was wondering what tips or comments the panel has for future museum professionals. Anything? Don't do it.
Somebody can take that. I have a follow-up question for that too. So, if somebody, maybe I'll do my follow-up question and put them together, because I had a question for Peggy that. Peggy is trained in art history. Tina Olson, who she also mentioned, a very innovative education officer at the Portland Museum of Art, was trained in art history. And often when you are talking about more participative museums, there's something sort of wrong and bad about the old art history and curatorship model, and yet these are engaging public programs that are very much emerging out of, I would like to think, a strong art history education. And as I see many of the former and current art history staff and students from Trinity and UCD here, what do you think that kind of preparation gave you as background to move in new directions? And of course, anybody can answer the original question as well, which is extremely important.
So should I jump in first here? Well, first of all, I would say that I find artificial the oppositions that are posited between object and visitor and between curator and educator, actually. And I would say the future of museum professionals, a vision for the future of museum professionals would be a much more fluid structure in which members of staff take on equal responsibility toward both objects of cultural heritage and participatory models of cultural production. I've always believed that education is not a department, it's a goal, and it's a goal that only works when everyone in the institution feels a sense of shared responsibility toward it. So certainly when I was a curator, I was very much oriented toward the public engagement with, because I was a European sculpture curator in Los Angeles, with a collection that actually wasn't all that popular with the public. I mean, there wasn't a community of old master sculpture collections in Los Angeles, so I had to work very hard to sort of figure out ways to engage people with that material who wouldn't think that they would have been interested in the history of sculpture. So it certainly was a sensibility that I acted upon as a curator and have continued in my life as an educator. But I was reminded by David's talk by a quote that I'm going to paraphrase, but I think it's somewhat relevant to this question, by Elliot Eisner, when he said that great works of art, no matter how virtuous and no matter how magnificent, are meaningless unless considered by a knowing mind, a seeing eye, and a feeling heart. And I think that really sort of posits a future for museums where it's both about the objects, but also about how those objects can have meaning to the people who engage with them, and how we create institutions that will make that possible and be open to that happening in any number of ways. And that is both a curatorial and an education responsibility.
Others?
I would support all that. I suppose I think the challenge for us is that we have very often seen ourselves as coming from single disciplines in a way, whether that's art history or education or whatever. And I feel we can only be effective as professionals if we are multidisciplinary. And that's really challenging, because it means that we've almost got to get several trainings, really, to be effective. And I think that's true for large institutions as well as small ones. I think we can't any of us take refuge in single disciplines, even in very large institutions, because the likelihood is we won't be effective if we do. And the reason why this is even harder these days than it was before is that the cost of training oneself is getting higher and higher, and the opportunity to recoup that cost through professional work afterwards gets slimmer. So nobody's saying that this is an easy process at all. But nevertheless, if one's talking about what society needs as opposed to the conditions under which we have to operate, then I suppose what society needs is museum professionals who are deeply attuned to how people think and feel and operate, who have a deep understanding of the disciplines that their collections represent, and actually have had a training in integrating those things. Because if one doesn't know how to integrate understanding of humans and understanding of collections, if there is a distinction between them in every case, and doesn't know how to do that, then the quality of the work that results will be poor or deficient in one direction or another.
Yes.
I would just like to add something. I totally agree with David that training or trying to gain skills or knowledge in multiple disciplines is essential. I would like to point out that from my viewpoint, having a sort of like a European outlook on this, also the mobility, even for short-term periods of professionals, is very important. Because when we're talking about key trends of museums for the 21st century, in this kind of context, we're mainly focusing on Ireland, the UK. And looking at Europe, the picture is quite different. Participation of audiences, visitor orientation are maybe not so central, or they are central in an academic discourse, but not in practice. So I would like to say that the exchange of practices and the mobility of people is important to learn from others, also at no cost or low cost, the cost of travel maybe. So peer learning is important. And in this respect, I think that it is quite encouraging to know that the next European program, which is until now called Lifelong Learning, will be probably called Erasmus for All, which says that everyone at every age is encouraged to travel and to learn from others in other countries. So I think this could be a way of bridging a gap in training or in skills that we will all encounter always.
Absolutely. Michael.
I'd like to begin by thanking the speakers for this morning's elegant presentations, which I listened to very carefully and enjoyed very much. Everything from the practice in the Metropolitan Museum to David's exposition of the human rights interest, as it were, of the citizens in visiting their museums and their absolute right to access to their cultural heritage in every shape or form that it takes. What I didn't hear, and I'd now like to pose it as a question, is I didn't hear anything about that was not, in fact, already internalized, at least in Anglophone countries, in museum practice. The interventions by contemporary artists, for example, the participatory element, which museums great and small strive to achieve. The unannounced interventions from right in the middle of the audience as well, whether it's musical or spoken or in some other way. All of this is part of the practice of museums today in North America, obviously, and to a fair extent in these islands as well, and to some extent also in mainland Europe. My question is, accepting that, or perhaps you reject that, but I think you'd be wrong, would each of you name one key trend that is going to stand out and determine museum practice in the future and shape the museums of the future? Just one trend per capita. Thank you.
Anyone really to take on Michael Ryan's challenge? Yes.
Thank you, Michael. There are quite a number of things one could say, so I will just draw on my own experience. My own experience is that from the early days when I started in this institution, most of the activities that I would have seen here, the few that were in existence, and many of the ones that I would have seen overseas, I worked for a while in the States and studied in London and France, were passive. They were not participatory. They were ones where you went to a lecture, where you followed a tour, where you listened to a very fine talk, where you attended a seminar, where they were essentially situations where an expert or a specialist or a curator or whoever it was imparting information to the visitor who was sitting and listening, and at the end there might have been a discussion. In my time, what I have seen the big change in is a huge desire by the public to participate in the whole notion of the museum, in the whole understanding of what the objects, the artworks are. And I would say even more strongly that where in this institution we do a fair division between events like lectures and all the rest, we also do quite a lot of courses like drawing studies courses. And if we still had the rooms and the facilities to do them, we wouldn't be able to keep up with the demand for them. There is an increasing demand by the public, not just to participate and try to understand the objects. They want to try out drawing them, finding ways of interacting so that they gain their own personal understanding of something that might have motivated the construct or the drawing or the inspiration behind the object. It is not to say that we're dealing with the public who want to be the craftsperson or the originator of the object, but that whole theme of creativity that has come out several times today, there is a public who are beginning to be more and more aware of their own innate creativity, but now increasingly they want to try it out. And I think this is only positive for museums, libraries, galleries, whatever, because it means exactly what Sarah was referring to, is that they're taking a greater sense of ownership of the museum. That if it's well handled within the museum, it builds up a community. People feel that their voice is being listened to, and therefore the museum does feel as though it's engaging with its public.
Others?
Can I jump in?
Yes.
I would say that while some of the ideas embedded in the programs that are taking place in museums may not seem new, so drawing, sketching from original works of art is not necessarily new, and artists' interventions into historical collections certainly is not new. One of the points that I was trying to make is that the way that those things are approached and what actually happens when it takes place is quite new. First of all, these things are happening more and more within the gallery spaces themselves, not in a lecture hall or auditorium like this, not in a classroom, but in the galleries themselves. They are crossing artistic genres, so there are increasingly blurred boundaries between performance and visual art. I believe that is also new. They are open-ended in terms of their outcomes, which is also not completely new, but certainly much more notable than it used to be. And I do think that museums are very much affected right now, or becoming more affected, by the DIY communities, where people are initiating their own learning experiences, their own learning communities, and using the museum as a resource for doing that. And that really is completely new, to have these programs that are being spontaneously generated by communities of people outside the frameworks of program design within the museum, and that museums are open to that happening. I think that's both new in the sense that these DIY communities are becoming a phenomenon that has really taken off, and that represents a very different and much more self-directed attitude toward lifelong learning, and that museums are sort of becoming open to these things taking place within their galleries, I see as something that characterizes the present and will continue into the future.
So greater participation of the public in the museum is a key trend.
David?
Of course, I deny I'm wrong. But even allowing for the fact that just may be remotely possible, I suppose that should be there. I would say regeneration. And I actually tried to avoid getting into too much prediction in talking about the future for museums, but I'm going to break my own rule here. What we're going to see, I think, driven partly by financial imperatives, is the retreat of empire. Retreat of national institutions perforce, unless they're lucky enough to be able to generate a lot of income or to have a lot of private backing. And the consequence of that is going to be that what I was describing as peripheries, actually I shouldn't describe them as peripheries. I'm reminded of a story of a woman from North Wales who went for the first time to London to visit her daughter who was working there. And she came back and said that London was very fine, but it's very remote. And she's completely right. It is very remote, and Cardiff's very remote as well. I think a reality is going to be that communities are going to need to take culture back to themselves, because the support that might have been there before may not any longer be there in future. And some of the things that were to do with lifelong learning, for example, and independent and self-directed learning, I think are there. I think that the web will prompt it, and also the wish for people to participate more will prompt this as well. And it can only really happen locally in a most active way, in a context of economic deprivation and loss of public service support as well. And I think there'll be good things and there'll be bad things coming from that, but nevertheless, I think it's what I would predict as a likely trend.
Sarah, do you want to weigh in? I don't want to put you on the spot.
Actually, a very short answer. I think the key trends that we'll see would be change, greater fluidity, and I think a greater accountability to the public. That would be my...
If I may be permitted to make my own prediction as well, I think one of the great challenges is going to be that a lot of the art of the period since the creation of the art museum has been made to eventually potentially go into the art museum. And I think a great deal of art today, including some of the art that we saw occurring in the art museum, is ephemeral. And how 50 years from now or 100 years from now will you be able to experience what 2012 was like artistically? How are museums going to adapt to the changes in art production that mean that their role of conserving our cultural past changes as well? But I'm, other questions, yes.
Hi, I think that the question Michael asked was actually really interesting, and I really enjoyed all of the papers from all of the speakers today. My question actually is in sort of relating it back slightly to what David was talking about. Bourdieu argued that that in a contemporary context, that when novel ideas and novel programs and novel things come upon us, that the instruments of perception that we have in today's society are based on old ideas and old things, and so we can't really use the instruments that we currently have to understand true innovation, because those because it hasn't been digested, so to speak. I wondered if the people that we have on the panel might comment on ways in which museums and other sorts of cultural institutions can be can try to be nimble enough to make sure that the types of programs, displays, and interpretations that were imposed today on the past or even on the contemporary society might be able to maintain their relevance in a context where demographics are increasingly dynamic and seem to, you know, be moving much more so in that trend rather than slowing down, and how we might be the innovators of those instruments for future generations.
Open it up to the panel, if anyone's.
Yeah, I'll start, but I'm sure I won't finish on that one. Charles Leadbeater said that the great development of the 19th century was the institution. The great development of the 21st century is the network. Working in an institution, and a very large one as well, I think it can be very difficult for institutions to be nimble, to work with networks. And I think that's one of our challenges. And also, I think the implication of the question was that we, you know, how can we, in a sense, drive some of that process? And I think it's very hard to do so. I think increasingly we find ourselves responding to rather than driving some of that. And that's not necessarily bad. I'll stop there.
I guess I, in trying to understand your question, I sort of see two parts, and one is the relevance and one is the invention of new instruments. And I guess what I would like to say is that those two things don't necessarily go together, and while I do think it's difficult for museums to invent new, entirely new instruments, as Michael pointed out, I don't think that necessarily sentences the museum to become irrelevant. And I'd like to just share one example from recent programming at the Met. We opened our new galleries for the Arts of the Arab Lands, Turkey, Iran, Central Asia, and later South Asia, which I realize is a mouthful. They are the new galleries for the Islamic Art Department. They're named that in order specifically to convey a sense of these regions of the world as diverse and Muslim identity as non-monolithic. They opened this past fall, very close to the 10th anniversary of September 11th in New York City. And the galleries themselves are conceived to be able to showcase an understanding of the art of the Islamic world that is more complex and nuanced than what we are exposed to in the media, but the programs definitely were conceived to support that goal. And so, for instance, we recently held a panel discussion on women in the Muslim world. Now, a panel discussion is hardly a new vehicle that we invented. Nonetheless, we did survey and interview participants in the audience that evening, and had an overwhelming number of comments that indicated that people felt that their understanding was changed or expanded in contrast to what they see, hear, and read in the media. And so, of course, the conundrum of education in general, and certainly multicultural education, is that we only create new knowledge based, of course, on our pre-existing frameworks of experience, and so it's very difficult to create shifts in perception or expansions of understanding. But it does seem that sometimes through traditional programs, we actually can at least begin to try and achieve that. So I wouldn't say that the invention of new vehicles is a necessary prerequisite to museums continuing to be relevant to different communities.
I have a question here that I one of the cards that I'd like to go ahead and ask David now. How would he resolve the issue of the Benin bronzes? It's one of the questions that came to me.
I have to sort of preface this by saying I wouldn't dream of suggesting to Neil McGregor how he resolves this this question. It would be quite inappropriate to do so. I mean, in a sense, this is the whole restitution question, isn't it, really, with brass knobs on it, too. And I don't think that there's a single answer to that question in restitution as well. I know that ways in which the British Museum has attempted to resolve this question in the past has included involving curators from the countries of origin in developing exhibits in partnership with the British Museum, which then go back to the country of origin as well. I think the issue which braver museums have started to address is to whether that solution is going far enough, really. And in some instances, institutions like Glasgow, I understand, but some of their works and Royal Museum of Scotland as well, have actually gone a further step and have returned collections to countries of origin as well, recognizing that even though they may not be held illegally, there can still be very strong ethical reasons for return. So I think I would just probably like to state that principle and then not go any further than that in terms of telling another museum director what they should do.
Yes, over here, just wait for the mic.
Yeah, I'd just like to address the social media aspect that was highlighted in the IFI, and this is obviously to everybody here, but really, obviously we see the importance of it now. In today, social media has just become paramount for every institution. And I'd just like to ask, really, how high up on your list of priorities, on your to-do list when you sit down at your desk, is social media? And if you say it is pretty high, which I hope you will, because I mean, it's kind of obvious that it needs to be pretty high these days. Why is it high? Is it high because of its commercial value and turnover you can get from your followers and, you know, new visitor numbers? Or is it because of its cultural impact and the message that you can get out there to, as you said, stimulate debate and discussion online? So that's to everybody, I suppose. But.
It is very high. Increasingly high in the IFI's agenda. As I say, it's not an area that I myself personally are that engaged with, but I do recognize its importance. But it's not, the importance is absolutely not just as an income driver, and if it becomes that, then I think it loses all relevance, and people recognize that. The audience on social media are very savvy. They don't want to just be told continuously, oh, look, we've got an exhibition opening, or this is our next event. It is much more about a developed conversation. And in a big part of our social media now is also the blog. And we use that as a very cheap, no-cost way of communicating what we think is important about what we do, challenging our audience to come back to us and discuss that with us. We invite different writers, IFI staff, writers, to say, I think the organization's voice is very, very important in that. But it's a sort of overall picture of keeping a very dynamic and constant contact with a large group of people, but as very much trying to portray the IFI as an organization that is open, is porous, has an open and flexible relationship with its audience, and one that isn't about a fixed position. I don't know if that kind of helps, but I think that's where its real value is. It's not about bums on seats or ticket sales or getting people in.
Could I add, I think that one shouldn't make any distinction between social media and exhibiting gallery. Increasingly, I am seeing institutions begin to have projects that are about responding to objects and to others in galleries, and then maybe working creatively with that inside the organization in an education center or something like that in a more developed way with equipment you couldn't get in a gallery, and then sharing that online, and that then moving backwards and forwards between the physical space and the online space. And I would expect that to increasingly be designed in by museums in future and rather than seeing gallery space as one thing and social media as being another.
I'd like to just point out in that context, too, the additional complication that one of the commercial revenue streams for many museums are their works of art, and consequently, the difficulty and expense of producing knowledge outside of the museum around those works of art has often gone up because of the expense of reproductions, but also for that reason, many of the works, and the Met would be a significant exception here, many of the works reproduced on museum websites are deliberately done in a way that they're not very high quality. Now, the National Gallery of Ireland and the Hugh Lane have things where you get pop-ups and you get better quality that you can't download, but those would still be, fall far short of what it's possible to put on a website were there not this issue of the income stream. So that if anything, the quality of the way in which most people encounter a work of art outside the museum, which used to be often in a fairly high quality book, and in the museum, that gap has actually expanded, even as our technology for reproducing these better and better has meant that it should theoretically have diminished.
Could I just add, though, I think some museums have been very brave about this, though.
And a very small number.
Small number, but the V&A was one of them when I was working there. Not through my agency, I would say. Through Mark Jones, the director, who was really passionate about this. What he argued was that you did make high-quality images available. You then tried to ensure that, so far as possible, where used for commercial purposes, that was tracked and largely was done anyway, but in the cases where it wasn't, it was tracked as well. And I would suspect that as technologies improve, increasingly that will be possible. I think the reason why this is crucially important as an area to look at is that if we're serious about students being able to reuse and creatively reuse material, if we're serious about the creative industries being able to operate effectively, a model which is based on no access unless you pay or through some other mechanism to high quality images is actually deleterious to some of the wider purposes of society. And I'm not saying this is not a serious problem for museums, and there are some institutions, the National Portrait Gallery being a case in point, which have relatively small collections in terms of thousands rather than millions, and for whom the income streams are significant, and I can well understand why they may wish to take a different route on this. But nevertheless, it doesn't have to be one rule fits all for museums and galleries. And I think we need to find ways of making really good quality material available for use under Creative Commons or other ways.
And I'd like to highlight the Met's website and the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam as sites that are extremely good in this regard. Yes. Google Art has been highlighted in this context. I'm just repeating this so that it goes on to the web stream properly.
I think there probably isn't a museum that doesn't want to engage more with social networking and technology, and I can speak for the National Gallery of Ireland. We've a terrific team of people here who are trying to develop it, but probably what I would say, and particularly where the collection is concerned, because the collection hasn't been mentioned very often this morning, we've a small collection, 14,000 objects. And it actually takes a lot of time to photograph the collection to the high-res specification that is required for websites, etc., etc. There is quite a lot of funding and manpower that is behind, that is required to actually do what it is you're talking about. I would say that we're 90% behind wanting to do it, but it's not just something that you can do overnight. Mm-hmm. And I also think, just discussing the participation issue, there are fantastic opportunities for expanding the use of collections, making people aware of the range of the collections, and particularly in an institution like this, where aside from the European collections, we are the National Repository of Irish Art. And when people come to visit here, it's normally the first thing they ask to see. Where is the Irish collection then? They want to know where is the Vermeer or the Caravaggio or whatever, but where is the Irish collection? Where are the Irish paintings? So it is something that some museums haven't been able to advance purely because it costs so much money and it requires staff time. And a good portion of the discussion already today has been taken up with the financial constraints. But we're very lucky here that there's a bunch of very young people who are actually handling, like, for example, Brianna Catherine this morning, who are handling all of this, and they're very good at finding ways around developing, opening, expanding Twitter contacts, blog, everything. And it is opening incredible new audiences for the gallery.
I hate to say, okay, I'm going to say that Olive Braden can get the last question. I'm sorry, but we've already gone 15 minutes over. So please.
Well, I'll make it very short. First, a comment, and to thank each speaker for their superb and thought-provoking.
Okay. To thank each speaker for their superb and thought-provoking presentations. I hadn't planned to stay, but after hearing the beginning of David's input, I thought, oh, this is different. I'm certainly going to stay, and I'm very glad I did. As you know, the National Gallery is in a state of transition at the moment, with our historic buildings closed for refurbishment and new roofs, etc. And it gives us a great opportunity to look at new ways of doing things. We have just started looking at a new strategic plan. And many of the ideas that you all outlined today are floating around in my mind. So just very briefly to ask each speaker if they would have just a gem of wisdom for us in the National Gallery as we are at this stage of doing things differently. Thank you.
Some short...
Okay, let's go for it. I think what I would say is that in the conversation we had really off the main sessions, I hadn't expected that a chair of a National Gallery would come from a background like yours, really. So keep on bringing in different voices and different perspectives into the institution.
I guess my one, not gem, but is that when undergoing a renovation, when galleries are closed, that's a moment when programs become even that much more important in maintaining the engagement and investment of the community in the institution. So I would say more programs.
I suppose, I think, again, that point of closure can be a very useful time. And as well as, I think it's a chance to think about different sorts of programs if you are maintaining a program during the closure, but also to, with less pressure of programming, it's a good time to look at resources internally and really, because I think one of the issues facing a lot of institutions is just that kind of ongoing, relentless grind of keeping things going. There's very little time to really look and talk to staff about why things are being done in a certain way or are there ways to do things differently. And even just a very small point to pick up from what Marie was saying about, you know, the developing social media is an aim but takes resources to look internally and to think about the different ways the organization can come together a bit more. I think very often we're all very departmentalized in the way they work. And just a very simple example, coming back to social media, one of our most read blogs in the IFI was written by the projectionist about his love of film and the importance of film. So it's not, again, it's not thinking, well, is that the education department's job, or is it's seeing everything in a whole. And I suppose a period of closure allows a time to really ask those questions and kind of create that fluidity that I think can be very productive.
And I would also like to add just a slight note of caution that David at the beginning asked something about, well, what would we have done in 1933 in Berlin? And the sad thing is, of course, that Berlin had arguably the world's greatest infrastructure of art museums and history museums at that time, and that they enjoyed, if anything, greater funding for the next 6 years or so than they had in the 12 or 13 before. So that museums, it's not just the fact of having museums and it's not good museums, and it's not just the fact of having good, well-funded museums. It's being able to think more critically than just sitting on something easy that way. I'd like, first of all, to thank our panelists and also Mary Bourke and the Department of Education once again. And then I would like to turn the podium over to Mary very quickly to conclude and wrap up the session. But thank you all very much indeed.
I'm just going to be very quick, and I just wanted to add to Kathleen's words of thanks to our panel, Margherita, David, Peggy, and Sarah, because they've been so important and central in doing what we said we wanted to set out to do, which wasn't to conclude the conversation, but just to bring it to a closure for the moment, because this conversation is going to go on and on. And we aim to publish the proceedings of this event hopefully early summer, so they will be available to you. And if you're not on our database, then it's important that you let Joanne and the team have your details. I wanted to also make a point of thanking the audience, both here in the gallery, at the round table, and also at the symposium, and particularly the audiences online, because our team here have been tracking them, and it has been fascinating to look at the results of the online, just taking from the conversation earlier. We got a report from the symposium of 1,000 or whatever it was people right across Europe who and the States who tracked into the symposium. So it'll be fascinating to see if that same level of interest continues with the roundtable. It's just not possible in a short thank you at a moment like this to express a debt of gratitude to enough people. But when you organise events like this, I keep saying this at any function I'm involved in, it is never, ever due to one person. It always involves a vast range of people right across the institution, from the attendants to the buildings and security team, to the people in the shop, to the people in all the different departments, and virtually every department contributed towards the invitation list as to who we would invite to this event. So I think it's terribly important to mention all of those people, including, for example, the people who cleaned the rooms for us, just so that the gallery would be super for this event. I also wanted to mention our team in the library and the research services who've been backing up this event online, ensuring that it's well kept up to date, who've been tracking in the emails, Brianna, Catherine Ryan, all the team behind there who've been doing all this quiet work. And finally, it would be very unfair of me if I didn't, if you don't mind my saying so, thanking my own team in education, particularly Joanne Drum, wherever she is skulking in the background. Adrian, is she somewhere there? There she is. Joanne Drum, Cuivon McInamara, and Brianna Casey, who have put phenomenal work into both of these events, and also our interns, Natalie Voorhouse, Quilto Mahoney, who was the rapporteur at the last event and who will be carrying through for some time yet, and also Gemma Sexton. Really, these are the people who you should thank, because they're the people who put all the work into it. Finally, to thank you all for coming. You are here in the National Gallery of Ireland. We would love you to take advantage of looking at our European masterpieces and our Irish collections while you're here. Little tiny display in room one, our little white box of fables and fairy tales in Irish art. It's a lovely display that will be coming down very soon. We'll have a study morning on it tomorrow. We've loved having you. Enjoy the gallery, and thank you for being here.